Rob's going to be doing a hands-on workshop. And after that, Rob is going to go grab lunch. There's some dining halls on campus. So if you're not familiar with the campus, you all can just follow me. Rob just had Domino, and it's really close. If you want to go off campus, that's fine too. There's a bunch of different places, but that would be your easiest option. So that's going to be about a two-hour break. And after that, we're just going to come back up here for the final three speakers. So it's going to be Joy, Tony, and then John. So John's going to be doing a hands-on event. Joy's going to be doing a presentation, and so is Tony. So I just want to say thank you for coming out. This is a little bit more people than last year. It's definitely more people from not Portland, which is pretty cool. You know, someone just said they came from Ohio. Someone come from North Carolina. Someone called me from North Carolina number. As you didn't come from North Carolina, but you came from Ohio. And it's good to see we have a handful of alumni here, so that's pretty awesome. So thank you guys for coming. So our first speaker, Mark Fisher. I didn't actually formally meet him at the Fitness Summit in Kansas, which was a loss on my part. And then I ended up seeing a TED Talk by Mark, which was talking about business strategies. And I honestly thought it was one of the best things I've ever heard about putting together a business for fitness. And that summer, so it was like 2-3 months after the fitness summit, I actually got to go down to his gym, and I got to deadlift, and I got to wear a cape when I did it. So that was like the coolest thing ever. We had a fan blowing, the cape was going. Yeah. It was really cool. It was fun. And I also got to be in a commercial when I was in there, although I really had limited screen time, which is...
It was, you're too much of a star. You were like pulling off.
You didn't want me to eclipse everyone.
Yeah,
I got you. Yeah. So, and then I was actually hanging out with Pedro. And we were talking about getting speakers for this conference, and Pedro highly recommended Mark. So, as soon as I got back to New York, so obviously New York, sent him a message, and he was very happy to come down and do it. So, without further ado, Mark Fisher.
I'm not disinterested in you. I'm very happy to be here. Before I begin, I do also want to start quickly by just acknowledging Justin for being awesome and inviting me and for setting up this whole thing. I think it's amazing. If there's anyone in this room that is part of Cortland, that is part of the university, has allowed Justin to do this, I think it's really awesome. And I also want to acknowledge you guys for coming and hanging out on a Saturday to learn things and get better. I love this industry, I love nerding out, and I particularly like being a room full of people that are interested in really being a success in this industry and really helping people. So without further ado, you can't have a business culture without a cult, just kidding, sort of. The reasonable man adapts himself to the conditions that surround him. The unreasonable man adapts surrounding conditions to himself. All progress depends on the unreasonable man. I want to give a little bit of context to this quote because I do want to concede that when it comes to training and nutrition, oftentimes people, in fact, need to be a little bit more reasonable. There's a fellow in the industry I'm a big fan of that hopefully you know. If not, you should write down the name Dan John, who's a mentor figure of mine. And one of the things Dan talks a lot about recently is people actually often, when it comes to training nutrition, need to be more reasonable. You don't often need an exotic carb cycling with a macronutrient periodization structure. You just need to eat like an adult and not have cereal for breakfast. You don't often need a complicated block periodization structure from a fallen Eastern European country. Oftentimes, be consistent with the barbell lifts and you're going to get results. So when I'm talking about being unreasonable, I want you to be unreasonable about what you can do in this industry. I want you to be unreasonable about the type of success that you can have and the impact you can have on people's lives. I'm a big believer that we are the luckiest people. If you are in this industry and you get to make a living sharing what you're passionate about, improving people's lives, that's an awesome thing. And I do not want you to dream small in that realm. So today, I hope to give you some action steps that will help you be more effective with unreasonable dreams. So our agenda is, firstly, we will talk a little bit about mission and values. Who are you? If you're going to be a cult leader, you've got to have clarity around who you are. What do you believe in? What do you stand for? Secondly, we need to know, who do you want to work with? You've got to follow your bliss. What type of training are you passionate about? What type of clients, when you show up to the gym, or the type of athletes that you coach, just fill you up and energize you for your day? And lastly, we're going to discuss creating a cult. You can also use the word tribe. The cult is a little bit scary, but I like cult because I think it's weird. You'll see quickly, I'm an eccentric fella. So at this part, I'm going to give you some actionable strategies that I believe scale to any size of business. Today, I'm going to use the term business synonymously with to mean both, like, if you have a studio, if you want to have a studio, or that could mean a personal trainer starting a career. It could refer to your work with a team if you're an aspiring strength coach. But just, you know, I'm going to use the word business today. You are all a business. All of you have a business, and that's what we're going to be talking on today. So really quickly, who am I? Who am I? So I think the New York Post sums it up well. They said, I'm the love child of Richard Simmons and Russell Brand. I also appreciate the end there. They say he also has a girlfriend. Because the mass media also thinks I am a homosexual. To which I say thank you, because many of my best friends are gay. But I do think that picture kind of sums up. MFF is not a traditional gym. I hope that after this workshop, if you haven't been to our website, go check it out. Maybe don't do it at work. Other things you should know about. So here's the things. So this part feels like a little bit gross, actually, but I think it's appropriate. If you're spending time listening to me talk about business, it is appropriate of you to be like, all right, fellow, wearing your wig, what is it? Why should I listen to you? So, MFF story, my journey career has been a little bit unconventional. I was a professional actor throughout my 20s, and all the while I was a trainer, but I wasn't like the actor that like kind of trained on the side. I was like the actor who was like, oh man, Mike Robertson's Single Lights Illusion came out. I don't want to go to rehearsal, I want to watch this new DVD, right? So I was really into fitness. I was not like the actor that did this casually on the side. But as recently as 2011, I was a one-man band. In January of 2012, Mark Fisher Fitness opened up a dedicated physical facility in Midtown Manhattan. Since that time, a little more than 3 years, we've had 3 additional expansions, and we're currently in negotiations to add a second location in Tribeca. Please keep that just between us chickens, because that's not confirmed and that can fall through. New York real estate is crazy. Also in that time, I went from being one weird dude to now a team close to 30 full-time team members, and more than 40 people on payroll. We started out in January 2012 with no clients, which we call them ninjas. We now have 650 3-month and 12-month members, and at any given time, another 160 people paying $900 a pop to do a 6-week transformation makeover program. We also went from having no revenue to, in our third year in business, grossing more than $3 million. Now, I'm not telling you all this to say that I'm so awesome, but I think, again, it's appropriate for you to know we've had some success with some of these strategies. We applied for, and if anyone's familiar with the business magazine Inc. 500, I think we're going to be locked for the Inc. 500, which I'm stoked about, because I will certainly be the only CEO that routinely does not wear pants to work, and that makes me feel really good. Other things that relate to today's content, greatest.com named an influential fitness person, partly for our success in building a culture that people love. I wrote an article for the Personal Training Development Center, which is a popular website you might be familiar with that had a lot of shares and is John Goodman's favorite article, he tells me. And I gave a TED Talk in February 2014 on value-based business. So before we get into content, the other thing I now say to cleanse my palate from the obligatory bragging information is I'm here because of these people. The MFF team is the reason for the season, I happen to be lucky to be their spokesperson, but for those of you that find yourself in a position of leadership and management, you will have the opportunity to learn about every failing you have as a human. And I come to you with great humility, knowing there are many things in this world I do poorly, I make a lot of mistakes, but I get to spend time with amazing human beings. And it's because of them I'm here today, so anytime I talk to people, I have to let you know if you find value in what we do, it is because these are amazing human beings. My final disclaimers, I don't have this all figured out. I will speak with conviction, purely because I think it is not great speaking to qualify everything with. It seems to me that, in my experience, it has been that. So I'm going to speak with conviction, but please appreciate, like all of life, like all of science, this is a working hypothesis. I'm confident I'm probably wrong about some of these things I say today. This will be MFF-centric because it's all I know. It's appropriate to talk about what I know. Our goal is to create some action steps. I will feel like I failed today. We walk out of here and you get some theoretical information that are not going to make some changes in your career and in your business. Knowledge is the booby prize. Action equals results. So by the end of today, I want you to have a couple things you serve with. Man, on Monday, I'm going to do these. I'm going to apply these to my career. And lastly, we will be doing some writing. So get out some pens, because we're going to start with some writing. So the first thing we're going to talk about is death. It's kind of morbid. Let's talk about death on a Saturday morning. So if we're going to have a conversation about your mission and what you believe in, I think it's appropriate to start with a 30,000-foot view and put some thought into what do you want to be remembered for? What do you want to be legendary for? So I'd like to ask you to write down one word that you want on your tombstone. What do you want to be legendary for? Think to your funeral, I hope it's a long time from now, where everyone you know and love is there and they're thinking about you and they're thinking, man, when I think of that person, I think this. This is that thing I think about them. You've got to start with that. And I know, again, it's a little bit morbid, that there's a little bit of a bummer, but I think it's appropriate we start with that context. What impact do you want to make with your life on this planet? So write down a word, perfectionists. I'm going to move you quickly today, so I want to acknowledge if you're someone that wants to get it right, I want to acknowledge that. I want to ask you, just let that go. Just write something down. This is a work in progress. Nextly, now we have some energy around what that word is. I want you to try to articulate a mission statement for your career. If you hope to own a studio or own a studio, perhaps the mission of your business. I'm in the fitness industry to you, but doopa doopa do, right? Or so-and-so fitness exists to yabba dabba dabba. So write something down, and it's not going to be perfect. We could do an entire 8-hour workshop on mission and values. I'm going to move you quickly through this. Take a stab at this. What is your mission? Why does your career exist? Why are you in this industry? Stated differently, what does the world lose if you are not in this industry? If your business ceased to exist tomorrow, how would that affect the world? About 30 more seconds. The last technique is called via negativa. An excellent book, somewhat off topic, Anti-Fragile, I think is an important book to read if you are a trainer and if you are a human. Anti-Fragile. Great book. Nextly, let's talk quickly about values, right? So if you're going to be a cult leader, we want to talk a little bit more about what you stand for. So if your mission is why you're in this industry, why you've chosen what I believe to be this noble career, how are you going to accomplish that? With what qualities? What do you stand for? And this is another place that benefits from that via negative approach. What do you not stand for? So to jog your mind a little bit, at Mark Fisher Fitness, for those that are familiar with what we do, unsurprised to hear that one of our values is authenticity, bringing our full self to work. And again, for some of you, that might not be the case, and that's okay. I was having a great chat with these intelligent gentlemen over there, Nick and Lou and Tony, and there are some different perspectives I think were appropriate because people have different values. Some of you might say, I don't need authenticity because I want professionalism, right? And I'm concerned if we, I don't want your full self to work, I want you to show up and do the job, and that's appropriate. That's not right or wrong, it's not my journey, but I think that would be appropriate. And often you discover in life who you are by discovering who you are not. So in Mark Fisher Fitness, often it's become clear to us what our values are when we have an off-pitch moment. In the world of training and nutrition, people come to strong opinions, they have strong convictions about things. And for me, humility is the core of what we do. I want to begin conversations with the premise that half of what I know is wrong and I don't know what happened. So if I have a trainer on my team and we're fighting, we have like those PRI versus SFG wars about the lat function. Y'all know I'm talking about, they're a nerd. Then we need to start that conversation knowing we have valuable perspective and either of us could be wrong. So let's have that conversation with humility. So what do you stand for? I want 3 to 5. I'm going to give you about 60 more seconds. We're doing this race or race now, right?
The muffins are in the oven. Now they're done. We're going to eat them.
So then write it down. Like I said, I concede we're doing this in a very fast fashion. Hopefully you have some awareness around your values. For some of you, you younger participants, you might not have put a lot of thought into this yet. And I think it would be a great advantage before your career to think critically about your mission and values. One of our advantages in Mark Fisher Fitness is I was already into my 30s when we started it, so it seemed intuitive to me, my business partner. If one is to open a gym, the first thing you must do is sit in a room and decide what are your values. Now, I don't think a lot of gyms start that way, but I do think for your career and your business, you do want to figure out what you stand for. What do you want to mean to people? So now that we have some clarity around who you are as the cult leader, let us speak to who you want to work with. So this is a picture of Triple H, I think. I think that's DeFranco's gym, which is a famous gym, I think, in New Jersey. And I bring this up here because oftentimes with serious strength and conditioning professionals, people tend to want to work mostly with elite performance athletes. And that is not wrong. That is not wrong at all. But this is where we must have a little bit of negotiation between following your bliss and what truly inspires you, and thinking logistically about where you live, where you plan to live, and who is actually available for you to work with. We have a lot of great coaches in this industry that are only interested in working with elite athlete extreme performance results fitness, and that's totally fine, but we do need to make some concessions to reality. If you look at, certainly if you want to have a studio, there's not a lot of them of substantial size that don't have a significant general fitness population. I think that is the, Tony, do you know like what percentage of Cressy are general pop?
I'd say
10-15%. Cool. Oh, that's good. That's even less than I thought, yeah. Interesting, yeah. And so then that becomes a challenge because people that otherwise you could help might not know it's appropriate for them, yeah. So again, I'm the last guy to say don't go after your dreams, man. If you want to just train professional athletes, I think that's a beautiful way to go. But be mindful that a lot of you realistically work with a lot of the general fitness population. Our industry has a little bit of a challenge, at least in the general fitness sector, because most of the most serious professionals are highly influenced by the people that are most progressive performance enhancement in a lot of clinical practices. And that's not always going to be appropriate for your general fitness population, and you may sometimes go down rabbit holes that are not appropriate for that population. I think Nick wrote something about this just recently. It was really spot on about that. So you need to think about who you're really going to be working with, because that's going to determine, ideally, the crux of your continuing education, what services you offer. Certainly, if you're looking to work with powerlifters, you're probably not going to offer battle rope focused metabolic resistance training classes. So you need a real clarity around who you're working with. So we're going to play this game. You're going to write a lot now. I'm going to give you like 2 minutes for this one. And you're going to write down everything about your dream client. I want you to give them a name, write down their age, their gender. Do they have kids? How many? What neighborhood do they live in? What's their favorite TV show? I really want you to get to this level of granularity. One of my advantages as someone who was an actor is I spent 15 years professionally pretending I was someone else. So by the time I started doing any marketing of any kind, it was obvious to me that I need to speak to people where they're at and what they're interested in hearing. Alan Cosgrove, who is a fitness guy some of you may have heard of, always says, if you can see what John Smith sees through John Smith's eyes, you can sell John Smith what John Smith buys. I presume he didn't make that up. It's kind of like a weird sounding thing. I can't imagine him thinking of that. But I'm going to give him credit because I don't know who said it first. So I'm going to give you about 60 more seconds. Keep writing. Keep going. You're stumped? Keep going. Write more. I'm talking everything. What are their fears? What are they afraid of in life? Do they like their job? What do they do? What are their hobbies? You've got to have crystal clarity. Because if you know who you are, and you know who they are, that's the foundation of everything. Because business, and I would submit interpersonal relations, is always a dance of you and other people. You have clarity around who you are, what you believe in, what you stand for, and a great awareness around who it is you're looking to talk to. So you can feel free to keep writing if you like. We're going to move on here. And we're now at the beginnings of a cult. Culture can be defined many ways. This is a very common definition which I enjoy. The way we do things around here. That is a picture of the MFF team being weird. May or may not have had some cocktails before that picture. And this is appropriate for my gym. This is absolutely appropriate behavior in our world. For some of you, based on your mission and values and who you work with, this might not be appropriate. You might not be able to get away with being crop top Iron Man, right? I didn't ask for the crop top, by the way. My costume designer did that because I have a costume designer on staff. I coached him. So once you know who you are and who you want to work with, that's going to really give you lots of information. The most obvious one, as I said, is the services you offer. Because you're obviously going to offer different services based on who you're looking to work with. And one thing I would challenge you to be very mindful of throughout your career, and again, please, guys, I keep saying, I'm not perfect. I'm not saying I don't fall into these traps. Be mindful about what you are passionate about negatively influencing the way you're training other people. You want to be very mindful, honest about what you find intellectually fascinating, not necessarily creeping in a negative way to what the people that you're working with or giving you money have asked you to do for them as a business professional. When you think about culture, I also want you to think about design, and that's kind of weird. Let's talk a bit about design. So at Mark Fisher Fitness, we commissioned a graffiti artist from Brooklyn to do a mural of this crazy, barfing, messed up, psychedelic unicorn. And for us, that makes sense, but for you, that might not. So write this down. This is sort of right brain. What color makes sense for your business? That's a weird question. Or maybe what two colors? And again, this could be if you're a personal trainer, presumably at some point you should have a website, I recommend, or if you have a studio. What color speaks to your mission and speaks to the people you want to work with? A huge competitive advantage you will have if you can develop an appreciation of design, it will set you apart. In the fitness industry, oftentimes we deal with people who are really brilliant at analytical skills. Trainers tend to be great at analytical stuff, and they're often creative when it comes to things like program design. Lord knows we have some very creative other speakers in this room. But trainers are not always creative when it comes to an understanding of visual design. Humans are visual. If you're going to build a cult, these things matter. There's an excellent book I'd love for you to read if you're interested in this stuff called A Whole New Mind by a writer named Daniel Pink. He's written several books that I love. I'm also a huge book nerd. If anyone ever wants to talk about books, I try to read 2 to 3 a week. I love books. This one is amazing, and the premise is essentially that at this point, when it comes to business functions, many analytical left-brain tasks can be outsourced or automated. You cannot automate magic. You can't outsource creativity or an understanding of narrative or empathy or design. So if you can either develop some proficiency in thinking about design and contrast and color, or if that sounds like death to you, that's cool too, then you might want to do, frankly, what I did and align yourself with someone like my business partner who is a design genius. Because design really matters. If you're looking for business success, if you're looking to create a narrative, if you're looking to speak to people, many people are visual. For some, they're not going to care, but the vast majority of people are going to really be influenced subconsciously by the way your brand looks, both in your space and in your website. So really quickly, here's the MFF website, which for us, I think you get a sense already of sort of what we're looking to do in our values. It's a very eccentric place. Our avatar, I will briefly tell you, is sort of the Isle of Misfit Toys. People that felt unseen and ate lunch alone in middle school. I am lucky because I like performance enhancement stuff because I'm a nerd. I'm like you guys. I'm a geek, right? I'm happy to spend all day in these places. But I want to work with the people that feel sad and that don't think movement is for them because they don't identify as an athlete because they were picked last for sports. So these are my people. That's why this is all weird and glittery. It's like purple and pink. That's why informality is important to us. You'll notice that picture, right? It's not a traditional headshot. I do want to concede the sidebar thing. I don't know what that's called. I'm not a tech guy. The sidebar thing. That's actually offensive. Don't do that. That is symptomatic of MFF. That's pregnant with five other sub-businesses. We'll be spinning off in the next 18 months. So our website cannot really accommodate that. So that is a symptom of our pregnancy. That is a bad design. I would also direct your attention to the positioning statement here, right? So that's a fancy word. Basically like, who are you, right? Who are you? You'll notice via negativa, aha, defining ourselves by who we are not. Mark Fisher Fitness probably isn't for you. Probably not for you, you're not gonna like it. You like to be hardcore and scowl, and it's about being by yourself and wearing headphones, like, that's cool. That's nothing wrong with that. You're not probably one of the weird kids. See, we were the marching band, so like, we're kind of the weird kids, so it's cool. And I don't really feel like hardcore all the time, because like, I'm kind of sad, because sometimes I feel lonely, so it might not be for you. Now again, I'm defining myself by who I am not, right? And again, narrative, right? I'm sort of telling the story. Please appreciate marketing, and the job really of leaders is you're telling a story. Telling a narrative, right? Something people can sort of get behind. Now, we are lucky because I am authentically a weird person. So this can be authentic because I'm eccentric. Some of you won't be able to get away with some of my shenanigans. But I hope that you can find threads of this that you can apply quickly to your business. So your website should reflect your mission and who you want to speak to. So our marketing needs to reflect who you want to speak to. So anything that references Beyonce tends to play well for us. We call our trial membership, or did call, we renamed it, was Just Hooking Up. Because we thought trial was lame, was like, we're just hooking up, right? I'm not going to text you, don't be weird, we'll see the way it goes. And like, you want to like, you know, text me like after, like don't do it too soon, because that's like a little weird, you know, but like, we'll see what happens, right? You're looking, right? So, that's why we call that. And again, it's perfect for our brand, because it's cheeky. Again, it's useful in that, frankly, it's going to be off-putting for people that want a different experience. I want to sell out people that will not identify with our culture. Another example of marketing for us is this silly picture. And again, for our population, for my looking to speak to, this shows something I love from a business guru named Thomas Plummer. It's another name to write down. If you like fitness business or want to learn about it, he was essentially the original guru, Thomas Plummer. And this is called Real People Having Fun, Not Dying. You want pictures and videos if you want general population of real people having fun, not dying. You want somebody who looks successful. Now, Mo and Brian, they're admittedly good-looking guys, right? So they're, you know, a little bit above average track, that's for sure. But on balance, it's a scene that looks accessible of real people just like you and me, just smiling and working out, having fun with our business. Towards these aspirational images of very thin women in booty shorts and athletic bras, and muscular men often black and white pictures with downlighting, with sweat being perfectly on them while they flex. And I think that will be aspirational to some people. My perspective is, from a business perspective, I'm fortunate, like, I don't mind, I think that's great, right? I think there's nothing wrong with that, but I'm interested in the weird kids, and I would also say that those people are so well-spoken to me in the industry right now, right? If you really love working out already, and you're deciding which place you're gonna work out in, right? That's cool, but that's, I don't think necessarily the business opportunity you have if you can speak to people that don't feel like they fit in. Again, I'm not putting it on you. You need to follow your bliss, because it won't work. If it's not legit for you, you won't be successful with it. But I would say there's a business opportunity for people that can speak to people that don't think fitness is for them. And I think that's a very noble use of one's career, because we all know our society can benefit from that. This is a video that I recommend checking our YouTube page. It's called We Are Mark Fisher Fitness. And ostensibly, it's another thing clarifying who we are. We are the people that cut gym class. Some of us cut gym class to go skateboard and smoke pot in the woods. Some of us are a nerd like me who took an extra physics lab and arranged to have baritone recorder lessons during gym class so I could avoid it. And every 3 weeks, I figured every 15 days was enough that my teacher wouldn't get to wise. And once again, I can't believe this happened again. I have a headache, Mrs. Rossini. Can I go to the nurse's office? We are Mark Fisher Fitness. Now again, you have to figure out how that works for you. This is not a traditional approach to marketing, right? I also want to concede, there's people that I think are better at like direct mail and sales copy. Those things are all cool. But what I love is culture. So you want to make sure, again, that's playing out every element of how you speak to potential clients. Newsletter, this is something you should write down, because I think newsletters is another thing that's stale. I think you want to be talking to people. You want to provide them content. This you can do if you, obviously, if you have a studio easily. But even if you're an aspiring personal trainer and you just got your first couple clients and you have a few prospects that maybe didn't buy a session with you and a few family and friends, if you start giving them content on a regular basis, they will start to know you, they will start to like you, eventually they'll trust you, and then they're going to pay you. It's called content marketing, if you want to be fancy. You want to be giving them information, you want to be giving them value, so that they begin to trust you and look at you as an authority and someone incredible they want to work with. They want to have a comfort level with you as a person. So again, this is something that scales. I think everyone should do this. I think blogs are a really important thing. Admittedly, lately, I've not been writing as much just because I've been doing tons of speaking. But I think writing and speaking are useful for your own educational process, because I believe it forces you to bring clarity and organization to your philosophy as a fitness professional. The other thing that becomes an advantage of having a newsletter is you can periodically promote stuff. Now, there's different rules of thumb about how often you should do that, right? Maybe 1 out of 10 times, 1 out of 5, sort of up to you. So in our newsletter, right at the top there, we have just a little tagline for a personal development workshop we do every 4 weeks. The other thing that your newsletter allows you to do is establish you as an expert. So one of the things you're looking to do from a business perspective in your community, you want to become known as an authority. And I would say you guys are lucky. I live in New York City. So there are a lot of great strategies you can do. You're putting out press releases. You're reaching out to your local newspaper, ask, hey, can I write some articles for you? Or if you ever need something to contribute to fitness stuff, if you're a smaller community, that's very bite-sized. My local paper is the New York Times, so it's a little more challenging. I can't do that quite as easily. But when you do that, you can start to use your newsletter to subtly, again, build the narrative. You are the expert. You are the person that's there waiting to take care of them. And in the meantime, you're going to give them information. You're just going to give them information so they know how to achieve their goals. Now let's talk more about creating a cult as far as driving community. So when we say cult, and we say, this was fan fiction, by the way. I was like, one of the ninjas made this one day at work with this picture. Thanks, ninja. It's cool. So when you're building your business, you want to drive community. So now I'm going to give you some more action steps to take to build community in your business. I will concede, if you only do one-on-one, it's a little bit harder. But I think actually some of these hacks you can apply even if you're just planning on doing personal training. So one of the things we've done successfully with Mark Fisher Fitness is calling our clients ninjas. It's a little bit unconventional. If you're a psychology nerd, that's called a shared superordinate. Shared superordinate. Again, I'm creating a narrative. I'm giving them the identity. You are the unseen middle school rejects, but now you're a ninja. I'd love to say that I thought about this critically and I was like, oh, you know what? I bet ninja would be inspiring. That wasn't the case. I speak in tongues when I'm teaching class and training, and I guess I started calling them ninja one day. Then they started signing their emails like, Ninja Kelly Jean, Ninja so-and-so. And I was like, all right, I guess we're ninjas now. I guess we're going to do this ninja thing. But it becomes useful because it gives your clients or your members something to identify. I will say, if everybody on Monday starts calling their clients, Tony and I were joking about last night, if you're all samurais on Monday, I'll be a little bit bummed, right? So think of your own thing, and again, you don't need to use all of these. It might not be normal for you, based on your mission, who you're working with, to have like a pet name, but it's something to consider, because then you can start to name everything around it. So our current trial is called Ninja Academy, right? Just hooking up, incidentally, was as successful as we wanted, I think, because it was too low committal. So now we have serious dating relationships when someone's trying us out. The unicorn. Don't know where that came from, but at some point, we start talking about a unicorn. Don't underestimate mascots. Think about professional sports teams. Think about when you go to a game and everyone's using the colors and the apparel and they're dressed up like the mascot and they're passionately invested. They have taken on the identity of their preferred sporting organization. So a mascot would be another thing that you could use. Is there an image or an icon or something that speaks to your mission and will inspire those you want to work with? This has also given us what we call top of mind awareness. Top of mind awareness. One of the reasons I like the newsletters is every couple weeks, I'm not being annoying, I'm just showing up in your inbox. I'm going to remind you that I exist and I'm here if you have fitness questions, or if in a year you go to your doctor and he tells you you're going to die and you freak out, I'm here. I've been waiting for you all this while, and you know you can trust me. Unicorns have driven us top of mind awareness. Now, I don't know necessarily how you can pull this off, but if you can, do it. Because people associate us with unicorns, some of you I've never met before, if you're familiar with them at that, you might know of unicorns. And there's a reason my Facebook wall is the number one repository on the interwebs for unicorn pictures. Because if someone sees a unicorn, they post it on my wall, they think of MFF, and that is great for us. You might see in those shirts that I'm a gym unicorn thing. Listen, they might have stolen from us, but I'm laughing all the way to the member, like, sign up, bang, right? Because every time people see those shirts, if they're familiar with MFF, they're thinking of unicorns. So can you think of something, right? I don't know, like a mountain, or like an like ocean, or an image. Again, think creatively about something that's going to speak to your mission and who you want to work with. Parties can be very underestimated as a tool to build your community, your cult, because you want them to have relationships with each other. So again, this scales. MFF now is very large. So we have parties now. We have 300, 400, 500 people come out to our parties. We have a DJ. We have drag queens perform. We have a band. We rented a bouncing castle for our holiday party, right? This, incidentally, I actually just love this, because this is one of my team members, her boyfriend proposed to her at our most recent wrap party, right? So that's like, gonna build some good vibes, some love in your community, and your tribe. But it doesn't have to start like this. This can be a client appreciation night that you ask a local bar, maybe do some cross promotion with them, to be like, hey, can I bring, 10 people in, offer them a drink special? Or if you're a real baller, I'm gonna, give them an open bar for an hour just to show my clients I appreciate them, to build some social relation with them, and as well as to cultivate their friendships with each other, which becomes very important. Now, this is again where you have to consider your values. This is playing with fire as far as it goes with your personal relations with your clients. And MFF has personally gone into that because we're a very personal brand. I don't mind my trainers being friends with our clients. And right now, there's 30 of us, there's 800 of them. It's a moot point now because we hang out as our own tribe, and the ninjas hang out with each other. And it's actually been controversial in the past year because the clients know, man, the team doesn't hang out with us the way that we used to. And no, we don't, because now it is different. Now there's like different sub-tribes, which I won't bore you with, but that starts to happen. We have a really big cult. But these parties become very important. You want to cultivate social relations. Maybe you can go hiking with your clients. Maybe you can have a picnic in the park, right? Or maybe you go to a sporting event together. What can you do to drive community? This is something that CrossFit has obviously done really well. CrossFit has done this really well in driving community. We like community for two reasons. Number one, it's good for your business. You'll get more retention. That's never the real deal. The real reason is number two, you get better results. And if you're working like I do with the Misfit Toys, these people's self-limiting beliefs, we've got to work hard to create some major sustainable lifestyle change. If they're part of a community that has like-minded values, that has similar practices, we're actually going to get better results, and I'm going to get them healthier and hotter, which I'm stoked about. Images, visuals, another important thing. So at our parties now, we hire a professional photographer, which is great, because we get amazing images that then go viral. So it becomes a form of marketing, telling the narrative of these scrappy underdog weird kids that started this gym with this unprecedented growth that have the wildest parties where everyone is welcome, right? So that is something that we've done very successfully, and again, it scales, right? Maybe you can take pictures at your client appreciation day. Maybe you can work to take pictures if you have a facility, right, of people in the gym. You want to be a part of their life, and visual images are important both for your website and for social media, for creating their interrelations. That's just a picture of the team. I love those guys. Thank you cards. Man, this is, write this down. This is one of those ones you can start on Monday. People love thank you cards. Emails are great, but I believe gratitude is a really important skill to cultivate in life. Gratitude is a skill. You have to work at it. It's one of the most important things you can do if you want to be a happy, whole, and open-hearted person. I think expressing thanks to your clients is great. You can go to Vistaprint and create ones that are customized with your business's logo, with your colors, with your mascot. You really make that happy feeling of they open up that card. They begin to really identify and associate with your business. At MFF, we now have different cards for different occasions. If you get a show, if you are getting married, if you're having a baby, condolences. So this is one of those things, again, you can start on Monday. You just start writing 1 to 2 thank you cards. And again, what I love about all these things, I'm going to keep hitting this, guys, because it's great for your business, but it's great to be a great human. Right? Be a great human first. A lot of the business stuff will follow. I believe this is a beautiful practice to get into. So don't just write to people that are going to serve your business. Write to people that have made your life better. Clients of the month, another great, easy to pull out thing. So we do Ninja of the Month. You can highlight your culture by celebrating people that are clearly living in your values, that other people aspire to be publicly highlighted. You can highlight them in your newsletter now that you have it. You can put them on your private Facebook group, which I'll talk about in a moment. You can post it on your Facebook page, and then you can give them a gift of some kind, maybe a Starbucks gift card. Maybe you can give them a gift card for your services. Maybe what we do, give them a gift card to give to a friend of theirs and be explicit, be honest. I love Jay Pinkerton. You're the man. You're the coolest. I wish my whole life was people like you. Do you have friends that are like you? They're going to come into this place and drink sweet, sweet, dark unicorn blood? Because if you do, here's some cash money. Send it my way, man. I want more people just like you. Right? It's a virtuous cycle because, again, you're making the world better, and it's going to grow your business. Another thing that you can apply immediately, milestones. Do you have milestones you can celebrate? Maybe the number of sessions a client has trained with you? Mrs. Rossini, I just want to say today is our 25th session together. Congratulations. I know you're concerned about doing this sustainably. I got you a Starbucks gift card. I really want to congratulate you on really committing to your fitness. At MFF, we do, I think it's 250 classes and 150 semi-privates, and we now have specific apparel that you can only get if you hit those milestones. So it becomes this bragging right, oh, you have the glittery unicorn and the glittery kettlebell. We also celebrate bodyweight feats of strength, which is another thing you can do in addition to number of sessions, and celebrate them for, you know, have a bell that you ring and give them something when they achieve a certain percentage of their bodyweight, their deadlift, or a number of pull-ups. And again, you can. This all keeps working. You can celebrate them in your newsletter. You can celebrate them in your secret Facebook group. And you just keep driving that community. You keep celebrating success and inspiring the other members of your cult to reach forward. Words. Words can be powerful. So, belay means belief. Talk about that a lot in the beginning, because in the beginning, and we still feel like it, we were scrappy kids. Didn't
didn't know what we were doing. I dumped in my life savings, put my business partner's furniture, and we're like, we got a business. We opened up a business. We talked a lot about belief in those days. Then became believe. And then believe that, believe this, just the believers. We also use words like glory. I say health and hotness, which is a specific term that speaks to our clients. We talk about anterior pelvic tilt and hyperlordosis as porn star, sad dog, extensive flexion we call sad dog, right? When you tuck the pelvis under, Care Bear stare. We have an entire vocabulary. The thing that I'll tell you about this is both useful, but cautionary tale. This can be exclusionary. You gotta be mindful. Because we've definitely had moments where I was like, you're not even talking English anymore. Yeah. Right? You're talking this weird tribal thing. Which again, as an onboarding, particularly from us, I got Mr. Toys, my sweet little babies, they're very scared. They're like baby lambs in the beginning, right? I need to really make sure they have an onboarding and that I temper our tribal identity with making sure that, yes, you too, this is for you too. You are safe here, right? So that's something you mind blow. Private Facebook groups, another thing, you can do this on Monday. If you've got 4 clients, do it, right? If you've got a studio, you can put all your clients on it. MFF now has a different one for our muscle clients, our hashtag gains. We have a different group for our 6-week makeover program, Snatch in 6 weeks. Snatch is dancer slang for ripped, for jack. I want to get snatched, right? And that's another term that speaks to our population that you guys probably don't even know what it means. It's like a weird term. But in our population, they understand what this means now. So we have different Facebook groups for different communities in the MFF world. This is a place to celebrate those things I talked about, and it allows you to scale your information. So here's a phenomenon you're gonna see, it's crazy. You know how each of you, once you start training, I know some of you are still in college, but you have a couple clients who are just like a brainiac, and then they come in, and within like 6 months, they're like, yeah, so I was reading on YouTube, and I was blocked, and you're like, what? And they just start reading, like they become students of the game. Well, what's great is, you're gonna get less emails if people are asking questions on your forum and your like type A leader clients are gonna start answering the questions. And in my case, lots of times they're more concise and on message than I am, which is a little bit humbling, but a good problem to have, I guess. So this is another way of driving that community. Again, if you do one-on-one, now your clients will know who each other are. Ideally, they're gonna live in the same neighborhood. They see each other at your parties. They're gonna start to friend request each other, and you're developing that community. Another thing that you can create a space for, and this is a little higher level we want to work towards, we have a bunch of groups now that don't have anything to do with me or MFF. I started the Ninja Book Club, but I'm busy and I read a lot for work, so I can't actually commit to reading what their books are all the time. So there's now a Ninja Book Club that we give them space once a month or once every 2 months to meet. There's a Ninja Cooking Club where they teach cooking skills to new ninjas. It's all food, it's by ninjas for ninjas, right? They have the Unicorn Glories, which is our LGBT group that has card nights and happy hours. Our front desk staff is called the Rainbow Wranglers. They also organize the Rainbow Wrangler Happy Hour. And again, this is great because I don't have anything to do with this. I don't go to these things. I just support them and created a space, and this is building our cult, building our community. And again, I'm gonna keep hitting this. Yeah, it's good for business, but more importantly, it's good to help people. Think of that general population. If you work with athletes who often have a very highly motivated clientele that will do whatever you say, if you're out in the real world with real people, you'll see quickly that's not going to be the case. So if you get community driving, that's going to be really helpful for you. Theme days, another thing that might not make sense for you, but you could do. Like a luau we did, right? You have these images that we can post that go viral online, right? Last thing I'm talking about real quickly for strategies here is very important in my heart, and that is charity. So this is a park next door to the clubhouse that was defunct and not used. We were able to revitalize because we found out the local elementary school, the kids would have to go into this mass transit hub, God bless you, Port Authority for the recess. We had elementary kids that had to go to Port Authority for recess. Oh no. Now how's that for narrative? How's that feel? How's that image work on you? We were able to raise $10,000 in 30 minutes. We broke Kickstarter when we did this. So one of the things I'd like to put forth to you, because I believe you're going to be successful with your career and your business, now you have responsibility. Now you have an obligation to give back more than just your business, because again, we're lucky, we make our living helping people. But if you have the opportunity to have any sort of public persona,
Now you can drive more change. And again, it's going to be great for your business, but that's not why you do it. So another thing MFF has been involved in is Broadway Cares Equity Fights AIDS, which is Broadway's preferred community organization. And they do a burlesque show called Broadway Bears every year that we've been the fitness sponsor. Now, yeah, it's great for our business. I'll tell you, it was the craziest moment of my life walking to Roseland in New York City, thousands of people, and it's Broadway Bears, sponsored by United Airlines, Showtime, and Mark Fisher Fitness.
What?
Right? So that's great for establishing my credibility and authority, but it's helping people. Right? That's the most important thing. And I really want you from day one starting thinking, how are you going to give back to the world beyond just your profession? So the strategy that is very scalable that you can use is find a cause that means something to you, find a local organization or charity, and let them know you're going to offer a boot camp. And you're going to make a donation of that money towards the charity. If you don't believe in boot camp from a fitness systems perspective, that's not my favorite thing. You know, maybe you find a different way of offering a service where the proceeds are going to this organization. Again, it's going to be good for your business, right? Because at that point, the charity organization is likely to promote for you. You can post about it in your newsletter and in your Facebook group. You can get your clients to have friends that are maybe reluctant to work with you, they're maybe nervous, but like, all right, I'll give them a try for a charity event, right? So it's a great source of referrals. It can really drive your business. But again, that is a wonderful thing that happens. I implore you, do this. It is the right thing to do. And if you're in a position to help people, that's awesome. I also want to just quickly plug this up. Some of you can look at after. It would mean a lot to me. UprisingNYC.org. Mark Fisher Fitness has incorporated what's called a 501c3. We now have a nonprofit organization that we founded and brought on an executive director full-time because I wanted to make sure that MFF had a strong social mission from the beginning of our business, knowing that, to my mind, we are very small for what we will be. Right now, we're still babies, baby pictures time. So it's very important to me that we had a full-time nonprofit arm of MFF to channel this amazing goodwill in my tribe. So what happens after we get them hot and we make them feel better, we have them have some empowerment? Now I want to channel that energy. I want to make an impact on New York City. I want to empower my ninjas to think of themselves as someone that's volition, who can have a positive impact on this world, and to reach out to the underserved populations of New York City. Because ninjas, we know a thing or two about not feeling seen and about feeling alone. And in New York City, there's no shortage of that. I'm very excited about this. Please check this out. It means a lot to me. So in closing, you got to know what you're doing. You got to be good at your job, right? So I didn't talk about fitness at all. And for those of you that know me, I will nerd out with any of you. I will nerd out with any of you. I love fitness. I love talking about energy systems. I love geeking out about the pros and cons of breathing and corrective exercise. But I'm most interested in helping people. So to be clear, I didn't talk about this, but I'm assuming you're going to be excellent at fitness. Right? I believe it. You're here. I assume you guys are already great trainers, and thank you, by the way. Because you know not everyone's going to take this Saturday. I really appreciate you guys. I appreciate anyone trying to help people, but you guys are really awesome. But just don't forget that that is why we do this. And I'll also say it is important for business. Mike Boyle, who's a guy who's some of you might know, it's a funny quote. He's like, oh, you're a great trainer? And no one will train with you? Are you a jerk? Maybe nobody likes you. Maybe no one wants to hang out with you. Right? That kind of is a good sometimes, too, because there are a lot of people, you know, I shouldn't say a lot of this, but it's possibly a great trainer. But if you haven't worked on yourself and mastered yourself as a human, so you're a wonderful person to be around for an hour, that's like, you know, that's something to work on. Because again, that's what we want. That's what I think. Because even if you want to do sports performance, right, you might not like hug your dude after he does a PR step. But it's still that people, right? You want to help people. That's why you're here. The other thing I would say in closing, find other superheroes. You can't do this alone. This is more fan fiction, by the way. One of the ninjas made this, and I was like, wow, that's the coolest thing ever. I don't believe anybody can do things alone. I am just a series of things I'm not good at. I really have many things I struggle with. I make a lot of mistakes every day, but I have amazing people around me. So if you don't have a list of like mentors, that could be something maybe write down. Right? Are there people in your life that you should spend more time with because they are where you want to be and you can match their patterns? Do you have peers, your colleagues, people that you feel around on the same level that you can have therapeutic sessions with, talk shop with, and both get fitness information?